going to adjourn the meeting and introduce, for the second time with great pleasure, I refer to her as infamous, but she's incomparable, our own New Hampshire's Rebecca Rule.
For a while and then they go out, but it's usually a little longer than that. But I do have some new stories for you. How many of you were here last time? Oh, and you came back. And some, well, I guess I could have told some of those same old stories. But what I do and what I've been doing for about the past 15 years is traveling the state of New Hampshire, and wherever I go I tell stories, and people tell me stories and I write them down in my book and tell them in the next town. And you may well hear some from last time I was in Newmarket. I'm not sure. They kind of all blend together. I try to keep track of who tells what, but I'm not that good at it. So I'm going to tell you some stories tonight. And from time to time, I will pause and say, who's got a story to tell? Or you might interrupt and say, well, that reminds me of a story. And then you'll tell your story. And that's what storytelling is all about, passing it on. You know, one story leading to another. Some of these stories are historical. And the first one, I'm happy to say, is musical. Speaking of ballrooms and dancing. It's also an example of, I think, Yankee humor, where you have to think a little bit before you get it. That sometimes you don't get it till the next day. Sometimes it takes 6 months. But this is a story that was told to me by Dudley Loffman. You know Dudley from Canterbury, New Hampshire. Dudley and Jacqueline Loffman play wonderful fiddle music all around the state and lead people in country dancing. And they do many, many gigs in a year. I don't know, many more than I do, maybe 200 in a year. And Dudley, of course, just turned 80. Still going strong. You'd never know it going strong. But he told me this story, and it was also about a fiddler. He said it was a fiddler up in Newfoundland, in Canada. And this fiddler, like Dudley, by night would go to the various halls around and play his fiddle, and people would dance. But to make a living by day, he was a lobster fisherman. And he had his own boat and everything. And one day he was out on the sea and he was pulling in his lobster traps, and the rope got caught around his hand and it sliced off the end of his finger. Well, he looked at that bloody finger and he turned to his mate and he said, "There goes B flat." It's kind of thought provoking, isn't it? Do you get it now?
Yes.
There goes B flat. So you have to kind of make those connections, a few connections to make. But it's there, but it's there. I've got on the subject of Yankee frugality lately. I've been thinking about that. And this story was told to me in New Hampshire, but it was about Maine. And the fella said that he heard this story of a man who was driving home from Bangor up to Franklin, Maine, which is quite a hike if you've taken that road. You know that road, yeah. It's kind of a busy road, and it was in the spring of the year, maybe June, I'm going to say. Probably end of June. And he was driving along, and he saw on the side of the road strawberries for sale, $3 a quart. And he thought, well, that sounds pretty good, but of course he was going down the road, so he didn't stop. And pretty soon he sees another sign, strawberries for sale, $3.25 a quart, but he's already by it. He keeps going. He sees strawberries for sale, $2.50 a quart. Oh, he almost puts on the brakes, but he's still going. But he thinks, the next one I see, I'm just going to pull right in because I've got to have some strawberries. So he sees a sign, strawberries. He pulls in, says, could I'd like to buy a quart of strawberries? And the old fella says, yeah, here you go, a quart of strawberries, that's $5. And the fella said, well, back down the road they were $3. Three and a quarter. I even saw some for $2.50 a quart. And the old guy says, well, you should have bought them. That's true, isn't it? You're here, you're going to buy them. This story, and this is what got me thinking about Yankee frugality, is I just finished reading a book by Carol Harvey Clapp. Do you, and does anybody know her?
Yeah.
Yes, you do. Are you related?
No, but we were the two farms in the area, the Reinhold Farm and the Harvey Farm.
You're in, are you in the book?
No, but
till
that was
the
good
cows
friends
come.
And grew up with the yep. eight Harvey children.
Yes. Well, Carol has written a book
yes,
called Till
did.
The Cows Come Home, which is kind of an expose.
It is
kind of. Well, you know how things go in families. And it's all about dairy farming and all the pressures to make money and, you know, trying to, you've got all these kids and you've got this farm and how do you divide up the land and what goes on. It's quite a wonderful story with a lot of humor in it. And Carol's father is Daniel Webster Harvey, if you know him. And he's a character in his own right. He's a character in his own right. What I remember about Daniel Webster Harvey, the first time I met him, he said he's from Eppin. I said Eppin. He says, you know how to spell Eppin? I said, well, I guess. He said, Epping. And then he said, you know, the old maid got married. They said, what's the rush? This is Daniel Webster Harvey. He has the driest sense of humor you're ever going to hear. What's the rush? Since the old maid got married, what's the rush? Well, Carol, so I picked a story out of Carol's book, and I emailed her because she spends winters in New Zealand.
Yes.
And I said, could I tell your story? And she said I could. So I've been practicing, and the only thing I need to remember is the name of the man. I always like to do the right name in the right place. And the man's name is Jim Sullos. Anybody know Jim Sullos? He's gone now, but Jim Sullos, did you know Jim?
No, I didn't.
Well, Jim Sullos was kind of an independent farmer over in Eppin, Epping. And when everybody else, you know, got the milking machines, Jim said, no, I'm going to milk my cows by hand. And he had, you know, 30 cows, and he would go out every night, morning, whenever, and milk them by hand, just himself, ran his farm himself. He's very independent. Well, one winter, the word got out that Jim had come down with the walking pneumonia. And he was doing pretty poorly, and there he was out in the cold milking those cows. And so a bunch of the locals got together and said, we need to help Jim, but, you know, who's going to talk to him? You know, is he going to let us? So they elected Daniel Webster Harvey to approach Jim Sullos. And Daniel Webster Harvey took his youngest son, named Matt?
Yes.
Yes, I got it right. Sometimes I make things up. But I can't remember them. Named Matt, who was about 8 years old at the time. It sort of the story sort of told through Matt's point of view. And so Daniel Webster and Matt go up to Jim's farm and knock on the door. Jim's wife is in the kitchen. Where's Jimmy? He's down the barn milking. All right. So they go down to the barn. Now it's dusk, going on dark. And the barn is completely dark. They can't see any lights at all. So they go into this dark barn, and in the story, Daniel falls over a trough, and the little boy bumps right up against the back end of a cow. Can't see anything. There's just a little bit of light coming through the windows. And so Daniel Webster yells, Jim Sullos, you be in here? And from the far end of the barn, yep, I'm down here. And so they make their way in the darkness all the way the length of the barn. And there's Jim Sullos. and he's sitting on a stool and he's milking a cow, and he's got one 75 watt light bulb screwed in to a socket right above his head. And he finishes milking the cow, and he takes that light bulb out, and he goes to the next cow! And that is Yankee frugality.
I can give you a story of Yankee frugality.
Wait, let me get my pen. I'm ready.
Well, when we were kids on the farm, the Harveys and the Reinholds were the two big farms in, well, we were in Lee, they were in Epping. And we, the older people would milk the cows, and the children had to go up to the farm, and a lot of my aunts and uncles live around the farm that my grandfather owned on 155, which is now the place where they make wine. And we had cows in our day. So it's called Flat Hill Winery. But in those days we had about 50 cows, and we would help them get up there and milk every day. And we would have to go up and get the milk in the big cans and come home. We brought it in, and one day I'm looking in it and I said, "Mom, it's the red swirls in the milk." Well, of course, it's from the cow just had given birth. And there's a lot of blood in the milk. It's called colostrum. Mm-hmm. And they said, "No problem, it's strawberry milk. Just drink it up." It's not strawberry milk. I would tell Susie about it. "Susie, you have to drink strawberry milk." "No, no." And the funny thing, I don't know what they did with theirs, but usually they let the calves drink that off. It was good for the calves, but the Reinholds were very frugal. They would try to pass it off on the kids.
What's your name?
Judy Wall.
Judy Wall.
Wall, W-A-L-L.
Judy, thank you for that story of the frugality. That's very Well, now I'm going to tell a story that I told last time I was here, but I'm telling it for Judy, because you weren't here last time.
No, I was
so you
not,
didn't hear it.
But I heard about you.
But you might have heard about me.
Yeah.
But it reminds, see how one story reminds you of another. I wasn't going to tell this story tonight, but it just fits so perfectly. It's a story about frugality. Yeah. It goes back to the Depression when people were bartering. I call it bada-bada. When people would bada hay for potatoes, or you know, whatever you had, milk, you know, for wood. And so the woman comes into the general store one afternoon, and she has with her a block of homemade butter. Beautiful homemade butter, you know, churned on the farm and then poured, you did,
yeah,
just before it hardened into what's called a butter mold, and usually made of wood or tin. And at the bottom of the butter mold, there's often a pattern, a raised pattern in the wood or carved into it, so that when the butter comes out, there's a little embossed picture on the top of the butter. Remember that? Might be.
Yeah, tulip on his.
A tulip. There could be a tulip on your butter.
Yeah.
Or an ear of corn. You know, and you know, just different little fancy things to make them pretty. So this woman brought in this beautiful block of homemade butter with daisies on top. No, they were tulips, I stand. With tulips on top. And she said to the storekeeper, "I would like to trade this block of butter for a block of butter." I know that's surprising, especially when you're from New York. And the storekeeper said, "Could I ask why?" Well, the lady said, "Well, after I got through churning the butter and I poured it into the mold, I looked in the bottom of the churn and there was a dead mouse." So naturally I screamed, and the kids come running and they looked in the churn and they saw the dead mouse, and now they won't eat the butter. But I figure what you don't know won't hurt you. So the storekeeper said, "You know, ma'am, I think I can help you. So he took that block of butter to the back of the store, and with a little knife he scraped off those tulips. And he carved in some apples. Took it back to the front of the store, said, "There you go, ma'am. You know you're right." What you don't know will hurt ya. I love when stories fit together like that. Same idea. What you don't know won't hurt ya. And then I was thinking about a story, and I think this is out of Nottingham, where the fellow was driving by and he saw hay for sale, you know, bales of hay. I don't know if he was a gardener or what, but wanted to pick up some bales of mulch hay, I think. And it said $1 a bale. Oh no, didn't say anything, that's right. There was no sign. He pulled over, and the fella who was standing there, he'd come down to get the mail or something. He said, "How much is the hay?" And the fella says, $1 a bale. Well, that seemed like a reasonable price. So the fella from Nottingham drove up to the barn, and there was the old guy, the dad, and he said, "I'd like 10 bales." And he loaded them right in the back of his pickup truck. And the farmer said, "Okay, that's $12. $12. No, $12.50. That's right. I have to get it right. $12.50. Math is difficult for me. That's $12.50. And the fella said, "Wait a minute, shouldn't that be $10? At the, you know, Joe down at the mailbox said it was $1 a bale." And the farmer said, "It ain't Joe's hay." Which reminds me of another story. I haven't told in a while, and I love this story. It's a true story out of Canterbury. A man named Linwood... See what you did to me? You got me going. A man named Linwood Rogers lived over in Canterbury, New Hampshire. Anybody know Linwood? He's a farmer. And he, in addition to farming, he had a hobby of woodworking. And he used to sell picnic tables out in front of his house on the Shaker Road, and he sold them for $16 a piece. So that was a long time ago. Guy came by and looked those picnic tables over. He said, "Linwood, how long does it take to make one of those $16 picnic tables?" Linwood said, "Takes about 4 hours." The fella who had gone to college, possibly the University of New Hampshire, did some quick calculations. He said, "$16, 4 hours, that's about $4 an hour, isn't it?" Mm-hmm. "Yes," Linwood said, "that's about right." The fella said, "Well, could you make me a picnic table for $3 an hour?" Linwood said, "Sure, but it'll take a little longer." That's Yankee frugality. Well, I want to talk a little bit about how stories evolve. And you know what? This morning on Facebook, are you all on Facebook?
Oh, yeah.
It's ever so exciting. You get a lot of news about people you hardly know. What they had for breakfast. Lots of things going on Facebook. But a friend of mine, Barry Lane, on Facebook today, he wrote, "Nonfiction is true. Fiction is truth." Whew. So I thought, my stories are truth-ish. I had a moment of insight. Because they've all got a kernel of truth. Some of them are as true as I can make them. But every time I tell them, you know, if you tell stories, they change a date, don't they? And so, just a date. And then some things fall. No, not some people. No, they stick right to it. But a lot of us, they change a date. You know? As my dad always said, there's no sense telling the truth when a lie will do just as well and be a lot more interesting. I learned a lot from my dad. So I'm going to tell a story that I heard, I'm not sure how long ago, probably after I was last here. A man told me this story. It's a true story. It happened to him. And as I've been telling it, I've sort of been making it better. But you know, stories, sometimes they need a little shape to them. And his story was, it was a good story, a good kernel of a story. And coming from him, who had experienced it, it was very powerful. But as I retold it, I found I had to shape it a little. And I was up to the Corner House Inn in Sandwich. You know the Corner House Inn Sandwich? If you ever want to hear stories, every Thursday night through most of the year, they have storytellers up there. And you can get a meal for $19.95 and a storyteller. And the meals are good, too. And there's free wine, just saying. Not that long a drive from Newmarket, but it's very, very nice. And so I was telling this story, and I said to the audience, which is a very sophisticated storytelling audience, because they go all the time, there's not much to do in Sandwich. I said, I don't really have an ending. You know, I don't have a good ending. And when I finished the story, I said, who's got an ending, a moral for this story? A man raised his hand, said it, and I've been telling it ever since. Wait till you hear it, it's really good. But the story goes like this. Joe and Lindsay were neighbors. And one wonderful summer day, Saturday morning, they were out doing what men do on Saturday morning. Going to the, no, they, well, they'd already been to the dump, probably. Been to the dump and back. And Joe picked up one of those snow blowers. He was so proud. He said to Lindsay, look at my new snow blower. I got it at the dump. Lindsay said, yeah, I dropped it off last week. Thanks for reminding me of that. Doesn't that happen all the time? So, no, well, Joe was mowing his lawn, and Lindsay was next door, and he was going to wash his car. And as he backed his car down the driveway towards the spigot, towards the faucet, he looked back where his car had been parked, and there, had crawled underneath it somehow, was a giant snapping turtle. I mean a honka. A big one. Joe approached it, kind of pulled its head in and its legs in, and there it was, like this big lump in his driveway, and he leaned close, and it smelled awful. Smelled like the swamp. Smelled like the muck at the bottom of the swamp. It smelled like the rotten stuff underneath the muck at the bottom of a swamp. Had a terrible odor to it.
How well, bad? How bad?
Really bad. Like the muck at the bottom of a swamp on a hot day in August. That's how bad it was. And there was this giant snapping turtle in the middle of his driveway. Of course, he's got kids, he's got a wife, the neighbors are passing by with their dogs. He can't have this giant snapping turtle in his driveway. What's he gonna do? So he hollers over to Joe. Joe! Joe shuts off his lawnmower, comes over, and there they regard a turtle. What are we gonna do? Joe says, Lindsay, do you have a snow shovel? Lindsay says, I do. Runs in the garage, gets a snow shovel. Big one. We can pick that turtle up with the snow shovel. Well, then what do we do? But then what do we do? Lindsay says, Joe, do you have a big laundry basket? I do. So Joe ran and he got a laundry, great big laundry basket. And those two fellas, meanwhile the kids had come out and the wives and they were watching the operation. And they slid that snow shovel underneath that giant turtle and flipped it onto its back into the laundry basket. Its little legs went like this. But it was on its back, it couldn't do anything. You know, they don't do much on their backs. They were awful proud, they slapped each other on the back. You know, wow, that was a good thinking. Now what are we gonna do now? Well, they each took a handle of the basket and they took it to the back of Lindsay's blue Subaru hatchback. And they slid that turtle, this is a true story, into the back of the hatchback, slammed the hatch, they got into the driver's seat and the passenger seat and they went off towards the pond. So proud. Oh boy, you know, a lot of people wouldn't know what to do with a turtle in their yard, but we figured it out. Yes, we did. We sure did. That was good thinking about the shovel. Well, yeah, but I couldn't have done anything without that laundry basket. They were awful happy with themselves. And they got a few miles down the road, almost to the pond, when they heard a strange scrambling sound in the back of that Subaru, and somehow that turtle had tipped itself out of that basket, got onto its feet, and it was headed their way. It had climbed over the back seat, and it was scrambling up towards the front seat. It smelled awful bad, and it didn't look very happy, and it kept sticking its big head out going, what did they do? They pulled over, they jumped out of the car and locked it. Now the turtle was occupying the car. It had taken over the car, and every time they approached, whatever window they approached, it'd be right there. Go to the back. What are we gonna do? They looked at each other. They didn't know what to do. So they sat down on the stone wall beside the road and waited and thought hard. Once in a while, one of them would get up and approach the car. Well, after about 45 minutes, a kid comes down the road on a bicycle. And he sees the two fellas sitting on the sidewalk, on the stone wall, and he says, what you guys doing? They said, well, the turtle in the car. Can't get the turtle out of the car. The kid says, well, I think I know what to do. So he went out in the woods, and he got a stick about as big as his arm, and he went to the back of that Subaru, and he lifted the hatchback up just a dite, and he stuck that stick in, and the turtle clamped on. And he pulled the turtle out onto the ground, and he dragged him to the pond, and he swam away. Joe and Lindsay were very impressed. They got back in the car, drove towards home, and as they drove, they agreed that they would never speak of this again. But the moral of the story is, wait for it, if you buy a Subaru, get a stick.
I guess you've got some of them here?
Yes. Chuck, I have a new book
out. Moved and Seconded.
Called Moved and Seconded. It's about New Hampshire Town Meeting. Yep. And Chuck brought it to the lead town meeting to sell them.
Right.
Yeah. I thought they ought to know how great town meeting is.
Yeah. Now you're talking about maybe not quite telling the truth.
Yeah, well,
I have the story of being a Quaker. We have a tradition of speaking the truth.
Admirable.
There was one Quaker, I don't know the whole, who it was or whatnot, the story is that one Quaker who was very insistent, he never told a lie.
Yeah.
And so there were some other members of the meeting that thought, well, he's a little bit, you know, carrying this maybe too far and whatnot. But, well, we're going to get him.
Uh-oh.
So they had one of their friends went to this Quaker's house and they knocked the door and was invited in and went into the parlor and sat there and they chatted for a little bit. And then a couple of the other friends came to the front door and they knocked and they said, is our friend in the living room here? And the older Quaker looked at him and said, well, in the meantime, this friend had walked out through the thing, up through the kitchen and out the back door.
Uh-oh.
And but the friend's response was, he was in there when I left.
He was in there when
I left. He was in the living room when I left.
Was in there when I left. He might not be there anymore. Because he would have been caught, wouldn't he?
Mm-hmm.
He was being very careful. That is the one that requires at least 5 jumps. I like it. Thank you, Chuck. I thought of another story while you were telling that, but it went away. Maybe it'll come back. Does anybody else have a story to tell? Yes, sir. What's your name?
David.
David.
Yeah. A friend of mine told this to me. It happened to his girlfriend, who runs a daycare center in Lee.
Yeah.
And this was last winter. She was suiting all the boys and girls up to go home with their jackets and boots and everything, and she was putting on one little boy's boots, and they didn't fit great, so it took her a little while to lace them all up, but eventually she gets the little boy ready to go, and he stands up and he's looking at his feet, and she looked at the feet and she said, "Oh, they're on the wrong feet, aren't they?" And the little boy said, "Yeah." So she set him back down and took the boots off and switched the feet and put him back on, and they still didn't really fit right, but she gets them all laced up, ready to go home, and he stands up again and he says, "These aren't my boots." So he sits back down and the woman unties the boots and takes them off his feet and hands them to him and says, "Can you go put these back and get your boots?"
Yeah.
And he says, "These are my brother's boots. He let me borrow them for this." So the little boy sits back down and she puts the boots back on, and still they don't fit right because they're not his boots. But after a few minutes of struggling getting them on, she laces them up, and so now he's got his boots and his jacket and his hat on, and he's just about ready to go, and she says, "Where are your mittens?" And he goes, "They're in my boots."
I call him the littlest Yankee. That's the littlest Yankee. That reminds me of a story. Told to me by my friend Neil English. Anybody know Neil from Epsom? He's a poet. He's a poet and a really wonderful carpenter. He redoes old houses using the original tools. He's very slow. He calls his clients the ladies in waiting. But it's very, very good. But he told me this story about his grandson. And he said he looked at his grandson, and his grandson had his boots on the wrong feet. And he said, "Otis, you got your boots on the wrong feet." And Otis looked down, and he said, "The only feet I got." He did. It's not Otis, though. What's his grandson's name?
I forget.
It's similar.
He's got a bunch of nice poems about the houses he's worked on.
Oh, yeah. Wonderful poems. If you ever get to hear Neil, he recites everything. Once in a while, he gets stuck in the middle, but it's worth it. The ones he remembers are good. But it's like, you're on the edge. It's like, will you remember that? One time, Neil and I, we got invited. This is one of the funniest gigs I ever did. We got invited to Rochester. They were doing something with rocks, like everybody painted a rock or something. And I had a story about splitting rocks, and the organizer had this idea that we would have a dramatic rock splitting. That Neil, they would haul in this great big rock into a hall, and people would watch as Neil split the rock. And I recited my story. It was quite dramatic. It takes a long time to split a rock. And yet, here we are in New Hampshire with all these people standing around waiting for the rock to split. I think I can remember that story. It's about Bill Twombly. I had to drag it out real slow so Neil could split the rock. But the story goes like this. Bill Twombly was a rock splitter. He worked down at the Farm Museum in Milton. In Milton.
Bill, I know Bill Twombly.
You know Bill Twombly? Yeah. And he would go to the Farm Museum and he would demonstrate the splitting of the rocks. And he was good at it. He used a hammer and chisels and feathers and flats and rounds and all that great old equipment to split a rock, to split a stone with a feather, that's really something Bill could do. Of course, a feather is a very thin metal piece. And so when Bill was splitting wood, he'd splitting rocks, he would pound on one of those little rounds. And just as the rock was about to split, he would pause and he would look at the assembled audience, all breathless, of course. And he would say, "Now you're about to see something no one has ever seen before. The inside of the rock." And then he'd give it one more pound and it would split open, and there it was, something no one had ever seen before, the inside of the rock. That's my rock story, my Bill Twombly and rock story. Rocks are such fascinating topics, aren't they? A story out of, I think it might be Gilmanton, where some fella came into the selectmen's meeting and he was really angry. Very unusual. He must have been shocked by that. And he had with him a rock about that big. And he went up to the selectman's table and he put the rock right on the table in front of the selectman. And he said, "I have been driving around that rock for 13 months. It's been in the middle of my road, and every day when I go down the road, I have to drive around it. When I go back up the road, I have to drive around it, and I'm sick of it." And the selectman said, "Well, you ain't driving around it anymore." How are we doing on time? I lose track of time, but I have a watch, see, which helps me. Oh my gosh. Can you stand a few more stories?
Yeah.
You know it's 7:55. What time do people go to bed?
5 after.
I got about 10 more minutes then. I'm always careful because it's much easier to stand and tell stories than it is to sit and listen to stories. Real, it truly is. It truly is. This story I thought of today, I haven't told it in a while, but it's a story for the season. And it's kind of historical in a sad way. For a few years in a row, I would go every winter, you know, in the dead of winter, to Chad Burns Restaurant in Northwood, owned by the Chad Burn family for many, many generations. And Bobby Chad Burn, who owned it, last owner, would have me in, and we'd invite everybody in town, and he'd make a special meal. Or I guess you could order whatever you wanted that night. You could order whatever you wanted off the menu, and then you'd get stories. And Bobby would tell some stories. He likes to tell stories. And I would tell some stories. And we'd all tell stories to each other. And of course, Northwood's a pretty small town, so we all knew each other. And that made it even better. So one of those, but Chad Burns is gone now. It's turned into a pizza place. That's all right. But it's, you know, these things happen. Things get sold off. It's good pizza, though. So we were telling stories, and that was the restaurant was just chock full, almost every seat filled. But a couple of strangers came in the middle of the program, and they took us two seats by the door. We didn't say anything, you know, we didn't want to embarrass them or anything. Mm-hmm. They ordered something, fried clams, I imagine. But after a while, I looked over at them and I said, "Did you fellas come here for the stories?" They said, "No, we tried to get into Johnson's, but they were full." But one of them said, "I do have a story." And he stood up and he told this story. He said that he was a retired state trooper. And his father had been a state trooper as well. He had grown up in the seacoast of New Hampshire. He didn't specify the town. But he said when he grew up, he wanted to be a state trooper, and he became a state trooper. And they sent him to F Troop. Do you know where F Troop is? Think Pittsburgh. If you hit Canada, you've gone too far. Now, the difference between Pittsburgh, New Hampshire, and, say, Rye, New Hampshire, is huge. It's like another country. But he was gung-ho, gung-ho young state trooper, ready, he said, to save the world. And his first week on the job, he was driving his cruiser out on one of those back roads up in the North Country, and what did he see? A house afire, a little cabin. He went to the back of his cruiser, he got a big fire extinguisher. He called it in, of course. I'm out here on a back road, I don't know where I am, sent back up, sent out a fire. He ran out through the woods with this extinguisher. He kicked open the door of that little cabin, and he commenced to extinguish, and he sprayed, and he sprayed, and he sprayed until he could spray no more. And as the white powder settled in that little cabin, he looked across the room, and there were two old fellas sitting on a bench going, eh. It was a sap house. You know what a sap house is? A sap house. That's a true story. And apparently that happens more often than not. People going by will see all this steam and smoke coming out of the sap houses, and they call it into the fire department. It's easy to make a mistake like that. Roger Swain. You ever hear of him? Anybody? Does that sound familiar? Roger Swain. From Greenfield. Oh, she knows more than I do because I'd forgotten what town he was from. From Greenfield was the original host of the Victory Garden. Thank you. I'm going to remember Greenfield because I always say one of those, where's Greenfield? Yes. I said one of those towns in the heart of darkness. That's what I call it. Have you ever been out that way? All these little roads go. Have you ever been to Lempster? Washington? Unity?
Yeah.
They're hard to find. I'm just saying. In Unity, we had a discussion. I was in Unity on Sunday, and I was telling a story. Said, I think this happened in Unity. They couldn't remember, but I believe it did. At town meeting, they had a debate one time. They had, don't have it anymore, but they remembered they had a street light on the main drag in Unity. And there was a debate at town meeting whether or not it was a waste of money to light that street light. And somebody, you know, who wanted to keep it said, well, if you don't keep the street light on, how's anybody going through Unity going to know they've been here? They voted it out anyhow. The heart of darkness. Well, Roger Swain, and this is a big help to me. It must have been in Greenfield I heard this story, because I was telling stories. I said, who's got a story to tell? And this fella in the back, white hair, twinkly eyes, came up to the front, and he took the microphone from my hand, and he performed. And he told a story, and after he finished, I said, who are you? It's Roger Swain, the original host of the Victory Garden. You know, a professional. And he said, I said, that is a great story. And he said, I've been telling that story for 25 years. It's been getting me through cocktail parties all this time. So I said I'd like to tell his story, and he said it'd be okay. So I'm going to tell Roger Swain's story. It's called The Electrocution of Eva Whitney. Do you know this story? Did Roger tell it? Never heard Roger tell it, but you might have heard me tell it. Well, the story goes like this. When Roger moved to Greenfield, naturally, he planted a garden out in front of his house because, you know, that's what he does. He's a gardener. And one day he was out in his garden. He was picking peas. They'd come in good and thick. And down the road comes his neighbor Eva Whitney. And she saw Roger out picking the peas. And she said, oh, it's such a nice day. If you want, I'll sit here and I will shuck those peas for you. Well, Roger couldn't pass up an offer like that. So he brought Eva out one of those aluminum folding chairs. Remember those aluminum folding chairs with the basket weave made of plastic?
Yep.
They were elegant. And he set that up. Did you like those? Are nice.
They're very light.
They're very light.
They're wonderful.
And when the basket weave rots, you can just replace it. You can just come until
get it all over these new folding things.
Oh, I know. Those chairs could last forever if you just kept replacing the basket weave. But a lot of people don't bother with it anymore. They're not frugal. Not sufficient. I bet you still have yours. Yes, she does. Do you collect them? Oh, don't even. You collect alone and folding chairs.
They're the best.
She
yeah.
collects
alone
and folding chairs.
The other ones weigh 30 pounds.
They do.
To haul them.
Nobody wants to haul them. That is something. You know, everybody collects something. One time, a woman was complaining that her husband collected dump trucks. And the other lady says, well, that's not so bad. My husband collects culverts. But I can see why you would collect those. I've never met a collector of aluminum folding chairs. I'm so glad to make your...
I have a few places to put them, too.
Yeah. It's brilliant. Brilliant. I bet you can get them at the dump, too. Yeah. Where was I? Oh, so Roger brought out this aluminum folding chair for Eva. Now, Eva was a substantial woman, so she fit right snug into that folding chair. And he brought her a stainless steel bowl, a big one, which she set on her lap as she was sitting in the folding chair. And he brought over a bushel of peas, and she was shucking away, having a good time. But something happened. Maybe the sun was in her eyes, or maybe the ground was a little uneven. But after a fashion, she decided she wanted to change position. Now, sitting there as snug as she was in that aluminum folding chair with a bowl full of peas on her lap, she didn't want to get up. So she scooched. You can scooch those chairs. So she scooched. And she scooched down a little hill toward the garden. Unbeknownst to Eva, Roger had installed an electric fence around that garden. About a foot off the ground to keep the woodchucks out. And Eva, he said it was about 5,000 volts. Now, I have since learned from engineers the phrase, volts thrill, amps kill. Keeping it in perspective. So Eva touched the leg of that aluminum chair to those 5,000 volts, and they shot up the leg of the chair. And they shot through the arm of the chair and up Eva's arm and across her body, down her body, through that stainless steel bowl. Roger said this was in the early days of the space program. Eva launched. And when she re-entered the atmosphere, this is a miracle, not a single pea has spilled. I see you don't believe that. But that is a true story told by Roger Swain, who would not lie. He would not lie. Well, we're winding down here to the grand finale, I guess. I'm not quite sure when I started. I try never to go more than an hour because people just get up and leave. I was at an old folks home up north,
yeah.
And I said, and they had a luncheon, you know, and then I was going to be the after entertainment. And I said, well, how long should I speak? And the organizer said, well, you should stop when about half of them have left. Does anybody have a story to tell before the grand finale? Already I've gotten some good stories. Yes, and what's your name?
I don't know how funny this is, though.
That's all right. Mine's not that funny.
Sorry.
What's your name?
Annie Boschman.
Hi, Annie.
And it's just over the border into Maine, but there's a fella named Bobby Brazier. Does anybody know him? He lives in Cape Natick, Gunquit area. But he's a lobsterman, and he goes out well into the end of the season. He was, I think he was collecting up traps, putting away for the winter, and he had a mishap, but they didn't know when. His fellow lobstermen saw him out and about earlier, but when they were heading back in to Perkins Cove, they saw the lobster boat circling.
Uh-oh.
And as they went past, they noticed that it was continuing to circle, so they started to look for Bobby in the water. And couldn't find him. The water, of course, was cold.
Yeah.
And after a good piece of watching for him, looking hard into the water, they did finally see something that looked like seaweed and a little piece of red. And they scooped Bobby right up out of the water and rushed him and covered him up on the boat and rushed him to York Hospital. And that's when I got a call from Marcia, his wife, and said, Bobby's in a bad way, come to the hospital. And I rushed up there, and by then they had started to warm him up, and he still wasn't feeling too good, but when we did get there, he was talking. And I said, it was just the beginning, the dawn of technology. And I said, well, Bobby, what you gonna do? You're gonna have like they have new cell phones. You're gonna have a cell phone with you. You're gonna get better radios. What are you gonna do? You're gonna keep in better contact with your wife. And I'm strapping a knife to my ankle. Apparently, what had happened was the rope of the lobster trap had gone around his ankle and all the day.
No sense going overboard. There's no sense going overboard. I love those kind of stories. You know, that comeback. Mm-hmm. Try to remember the name of the fella. Oh, I'm not going to be able to tell. If I can't remember the name, I can't tell the story. But I can tell you the story of Medora Snigger's mother, which is not exactly the same, but similar. Medora Snigger. That's a funny name, isn't it? But Medora Snigger, when I met her up in Berlin, she said she had come out of the woods when she was 17. And by that she meant that her mother was a cook, her father was a logger, and she and her 12 brothers and sisters had been raised in the logging camps. And a lot of times they didn't go to school, they stayed there the whole winter. And I said, Medora, wasn't it dangerous in the woods? And she said, no, we were treated like royalty, because the men from, you know, Canada, from away, they all, hi Chris, they all missed their families. And so they loved having children around the camp. But she said, one time my mother gave us a scare. That's what made me think of this. She said they had an operation where they would, in the winter, they would cross where it wasn't frozen, the Androscoggin, using a bateau, one of those flat-bottom boats. Mm-hmm. But they had a cable and pulley system. So you would stand in the bateau and you would pull yourself across the river. And Medora's mother had delivered a logger to the other side of the river. And she was coming back across the river, you know, in January, in a bateau, and the cable snapped, and it catapulted her into that river. And a couple of the little kids were on shore, and they ran up to the cookhouse where Medora, who was the oldest, was working, and they said, Medora, mother has gone into the river. And Medora said, I almost sank through the floor. I thought mother was gone for sure. But the men ran down, they got in another bateau, they went out and they found mother. She had happily, Medora said, popped up right next to the bateau. So she grabbed a hold and they pried her frozen fingers loose from the gunwale, took her up to the cookhouse, set her by the wood stove and thawed her out. Happy ending. Does anybody else have a story? You've had wonderful stories tonight. I'm going to end with just a couple of town meeting stories because my new book, which is available for sale, is about New Hampshire town meeting, which you don't have town meeting in Newmarket, do you? You do?
We're SB2.
Oh, SB2. Similar.
Sucks.
Like, I'm making a note. SB2 sucks. I actually have a chapter in my book called SB2 Sucks. That's a subheading. But it's not the same. It really is, I think, a threat to our traditional town meeting. And the other threat, even bigger, is lack of participation. I mean, the reason SB2 goes in sometimes is that people say, oh, not enough people go to town meeting. So I wrote a book to say, yay for town meeting. So I got a couple of stories. One is a story, Fella told me he was up in Gilmanton. I think it was Gilmanton. I've got to look it up. I want to get the right town. I've got a section on humor. Naturally, and this, she's laughing already, that's good. And oh, it was Dave in Gilmanton, and he told me, he said, I was the most powerful man for many years. I was the most powerful man at the Gilmanton town meeting. I said, Dave, were you the moderator? He said, no, I made the chili. Isn't that about right? Isn't that about right? And of course, whenever you bring out a book, people keep telling you what you forgot to put in it. So I've been getting a lot of town meeting stories. And a woman named Margaret Perry from Alstead, never call it Alstead. No. There's Alstead. No all in Alstead. Remember that.
I'm from Alstead.
Are you from Alstead? Yeah. Do you get annoyed when people say Alstead?
Yeah.
She becomes enraged. John once said Alstead by mistake.
Never mentioned the word again.
Never mentioned the word again. But she said that one year in Alstead, they had a lot of snow, and the roads didn't get plowed the way they thought they should have. So at town meeting, they had an idea. They said, well, maybe instead of one road agent, we need two. One for one and all. Alstead. And the other for the other end of Alstead. And so there was a big discussion at town meeting. And somebody stood up and said, I don't know why we would need two road agents. One is bad enough. So that's town meeting humor. And then I got a little section on town meeting wisdom, and there's an awful lot of it. So I'm just going to give you a couple of those, and then if you have questions, we can do questions and refreshments, whatever. But this one is from Horace Richardson of Moultonboro, town meeting wisdom. He always said, he was a selectman, he always said, you have to slice something awfully thin before there aren't two sides to it. Town meeting wisdom. And then a little road agent story. The road agent put in a plea for a new snowplow. Yeah, it was needed, no sense putting it off. But the old timer had his thinking cap on. He said, want that the same snow plow we had last year? Yeah. And want last winter the winter we didn't get any snow? Yeah. If it was good enough last year and we never used it, why ain't it good enough this year? Motion defeated. And finally, this is from Dick Wakefield, and he said, while it's true that people who disagree with you are generally wrong, sometimes they're not. And that's my town meeting wisdom. Thank you so much for listening. Because it said it on the agenda. I usually just say the stories are the discussion. But does anybody have any questions or comments? Yes?
So you talked about
Alstead.
And I know that, do you have, like, Berlin?
Berlin.
Is the same way. You don't say Berlin.
No.
And it's why?
Because, was it World War One or World War Two? World War One. World War One. We went to war with Germany, and the capital of Germany was Berlin. And so they said, we're not going to be Berlin, we're going to be Berlin. And they also changed the name of the mills up there from Berlin Berlin Mills to Brown Company because they didn't want that association. They're very strict about it in Berlin. Pronunciation up there is very difficult. I met three families who spell their name B-E-L-A-N-G-E-R. Boulanger, Boulanger, Belanger. And you better know which one you're talking to. Because they get really irritated if you mispronounce their name. Boulanger, Boulanger, Belanger. Yeah.
I have two aunts, and one of them's in a nursing home up in, I say, Bosca Wynn.
Well, I was born in that town.
Well, my other aunt says, no, 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 it's Bosquine.
Yes, it is. She's correct.
She's correct. Thank you very much. Now I know who to believe.
Oh, I know. And that's one of the B-O-S-C-A-W-E-N. How do you pronounce that?
Alston.
Where's the cue come from?
I don't know. Bosquine. Well, when I was really little, I heard it as Bosquine. And that's the way I thought it was pronounced. But as I got older, I think it's Bosquine. Bosquine. Sort of halfway between Bosquine and Bosquine. 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 Let's say it all together. I was in the town that is spelled P-L-A-I-S-T-O-W. In the town. How do you say that?
Plasto.
Or Plasto. And I said, toe. She says toe. You say toe. And you say it with authority. You know, don't you? She knows. She lived next door. Well, in what town?
Haverhill.
You mean Haverhill? And I said to this group, I said, how do you pronounce the name of your town? And one lady said, it's Plastow, as in cow. Another lady said, oh no, it's Plasto, as in toe. And then she said to the other lady, how long have you lived in town? 25 years. Oh. I still can't remember which one it is, but I take your word, Plastow or Plasto. Any other questions? Yeah?
Your comment about Eppen earlier.
Eppen, I-N-G.
Yeah. I guess, first of all, Dudley Lockman told me he heard a gentleman spell E-F-F-I-N.
E-F-F-I-N?
Yeah, and then I heard a joke, you might have heard this before, but what happened to the G in Eppen?
What happened to the G in Eppen?
It went over to Exeter.
It went over to Exeter. Well, there's a story about Eppen. About the railroad, you know, comes right through Eppen, and a fellow was on there, and he was kind of disorderly, and the conductor was getting upset with him, and he was kind of speaking to him about how he shouldn't be drinking on the train and so forth. He better sit upright and do his, you know, be what he was supposed to be and not be misbehaving on the train. And the conductor says, where are you going anyway? And the fellow says, go to hell. And he says, no, but the closest we come is Eppen. Eppen, why is Eppen the center of the universe?
Yes.
The epicenter? The Eppen center? Well, they say that Wakefield is the center of New England. Have you heard that? No, if you measure from the top of Maine to the bottom of Rhode Island and out into the ocean and back across, they say Wakefield is the center of New England. I find that a little hard to believe, but someone has done the math. Yes?
I have a joke that Daniel Harvey told me about Eppen. He says, how many Eppenites does it take to eat a squirrel? 3, 2 to watch for traffic.
Oh, that's a beauty. Oh, I'm getting so much good material. You don't even have to pay me historical.
right here. I can hear it.
Maybe not. Well, thank you all. I've had a great time. I wondered how it would go since I was here just a few months ago, but thanks for inviting me back. Am I coming back next month, too?
Maybe.
Maybe. Maybe so.